If you want to be helped, help the world, help the world. And so I'm throwing all my effort into helping the world. Let your consideration be, what is it that's truly going to be helpful to everyone? And I would say that your attention established in the light that appears as light is the way to be truly helpful to the world. And so we really have to push towards this. This is a transcendent light. This light transcends the dynamics of electromagnetic realm with all of its physicality and sensuality and birth and death and all this stuff. It transcends that because all of this is just actually a play of light superimposed upon light. So it seems that light appearing not to be light, whereas the light that appears as light reassures us that we can trust the light. We truly can't trust the light, that all of this was just a play. Now, the qualities of this light, as far as I've been able to experience, are transcendent again. Absolute stillness, absolute peace, absolute equal sameness, absolute seamlessness, absolute passivity, neither coming or going, not making deals, not emphasizing this or that, even sameness, smoothed out smoothness, total calm, no agenda, simply present. And to have your attention fixed on that is how you can help the world, actually. So there are several steps that need to be taken, and they all have to do with proving to yourself that you can do it. And so, like last night, early this morning, I was able to prove to myself that I was able to meditate on this light, even though my attention kept dropping away. I said, hey, it is possible. It is possible for our attention to turn to this light. And then the other one is to sit quietly for several hours, actually. I would say you need to make it a goal. 2 hours, be able to sit quietly for 2 hours. Now, keep in mind that there is this massive war going on for your attention. And this is not a joke at all. This is a supreme crisis, actually, because if your attention gets pulled down into the electromagnetic realm of frozen, condensed light that is incredibly, appears as if it isn't really light at all, then you're going to get caught up in this play and identify with this play of extreme physicality, which is really, it's a heavy trip that many of us say, yeah, enough of that, that's for sure. Not what we really want. It doesn't end up the way that you would hope it ends up, because it's all based on this delusion that light isn't light. This is some different light, and that you can somehow learn to love this new experience with this different light. It's not true. It's not true, because what we really want is the clear light. All right. It is the clear light of reality, the way light truly is. And to experience isness and the essence of formless essence in the way we are created to function. So, to be able to sit quietly and drop all ambition, the very fact that you're sitting quietly for 2 hours is a statement of dropping ambition, isn't it? Because you're not frantically strategizing and going places and doing things and texting and calling and arranging and organizing and, you know, trying to get, go. I need to be here, I need to be there, I need this, I need that, I need to change this, I need to upgrade it. This whole electromagnetic madhouse, you're taking a stand against it and saying, no, you know, this is not what I really want. It'll never be what I really want. So we have to be able to just sit quietly. The ability to do that is you get better and better, and you can do it. Then at some point, you'll be able to help others do it, be an advocate for this. We're not doing yoga. We're not doing anything in particular, really. We're sitting quietly, and we are at least making a statement that I want to try to get my attention onto the light that appears as light, the light of reassurance that shows us what we say, the vision of oneness, which is the goal for all of us, actually. That is the goal. That is how to resolve this severe continuity problem that we have here with this dimension, with this realm, right? There are other realms that we will also need to have a continuity problem resolved, but this one is the most, is the toughest for sure. Once we get resolved with this realm, then it's likely we will only have one more sort of small short cycle in the higher, some higher realm, and then get freed. In Buddhism, they talk about the stream enterer, the once returner, the never returner, and then the arhat. The arhat is the one that is truly free and has been able to go of all continuity issues and has been able to realize there's only the clear light. And they do not get born again, so to speak. They don't identify with any light other than the clear light ever again, unless they were to take on a role in one of these realms of step-down light to help work on this continuity problem. The never-returners don't come back to the electromagnetic realm, but they may have one experience in a paradise realm, very high realm, where they're able to let go of all form, even beautiful form, all form, totally. Okay, and so that's a short cycle they have. That actually should be our goal. That actually should be our goal. Once we break the spell and the hold of this electromagnetic realm, then we are the never returners here, unless it's in a capacity again of the clear light, out of compassion, send someone into this realm. We might find ourselves doing that at some point. But if you're not a never returner, then hopefully you'd be a once returner here, where you have one more go at identifying with this play, of watching this play here, and considering, you know, is this true? You know, is did light really become not light? Is that possible? And you may have one more go around. In any event, the capacity to sit quietly, drop all ambition for this world as much as possible, and to practice that is incredibly helpful. It's very helpful to the world. The more that we shift our attention to this formless light that appears as light, this incredibly compassionate light that reassures us that there's only one light, and light is light. It didn't become not light. It is light. The more we do that, the more helpful it is for everybody. Now, the world is in this terrible situation of attention not knowing where to go. I mean, I that's what I see. I mean, it's obvious to me. Should I go here or should I go here? And everybody is in this, like, wow, how do I decide? You know, it's just like, because the physicality and sensuality is being intensified here to an extreme extent. And we think that, wow, we could have some incredible trip with this. and then the other hand, the light that appears as light, the vision of oneness, that call is being made to us very intensely also. We say, huh, maybe that's what I really want. And so we're not sure. You think, wow, which one do I really want? Which one do I really want? And it's a matter of sorting out that process, sorting it out. Now, for sure, I know that the vision of oneness is what we really want. There's no question about it. Absolutely. once you have that, even one time, for just a brief moment, you will be totally certain that that is what you truly want, and that's what everyone really wants. There's, without any question, this is so. The vast relief from this great inner dread actually occurs. This great inner uncertainty and dread and fear of the abyss and all the stuff that's this horrible continuity fear that this electromagnetic dream gives rise to, this massive continuity fear, is resolved, gently resolved. It's not there anymore. And you know, oh, this is what I really want. So I do know what everyone really wants, without question. So that's why I absolutely advocate the vision of oneness, sitting quietly, dropping the physicality, the sensuality, dropping the worldly ambition. Because I'm absolutely certain that this is what everyone truly wants, really wants. If they didn't have a severe continuity fear, they'd choose it in an instant. Everyone would, without exception, they would choose it in an instant. But the defenses against the continuity fear can be massive. And that's why people seem to be, you know, driven here and there. And, you know, I've battled it too. I have to still battle it. Like, wow. You know, don't go back into the music. Don't go back into this. Don't go back into the romanticism. Don't go back into that stuff. But it seems familiar, right? So as you forge ahead into the unfamiliar, you end up retreating back into the familiar. It's like two steps forward, one step back. Two steps forward, one step back. Well, because of this war is so intense now, we have to do a little bit better than that, actually. You know, how about two steps forward, take a deep breath, and then two more steps forward. That's better. That's better. That's what I'm trying to do. I mean, I made a mistake last night, where at the end of the day, I just pushed so hard the whole day, and I just felt like flat after. I was so tired and flat. And I said, what do I do with my time? And I said, well, let me listen to this song on YouTube. And then one song led to another, led to another, led to another. And even though I knew I was getting sucked into it, I said, wait a minute, just this one more here. This I'm going to try. Maybe this one can catch her, you know, how I feel. Yeah, it was a mistake. It was a mistake, for sure. It wasn't a terrible, it didn't drag me down terribly, but it could have and can. And I've been dragged down many, many times. My attention getting dragged back down, thinking, well, there must be a nice way to keep my attention on this electromagnetic realm of light appearing not to be light, is a way to put it. When we perceive this realm, it's as if light is not light anymore. This electromagnetic light does not seem like the light we're used to at all. It seems like a different light. It really does. And our perception, again, it gives rise to perception. All this is, wow, this is like a completely different experience than reality. And so we assume that our will was able to enable light to create a new light, essentially. We're able to create a new light. And this is the new light here. It's not true. It's not true. It's the same light, but we told the light to present, to act as if it wasn't the light. And so this is the realm that we get. This is the experience that we get. And all we need is for light to tell us, hey, indeed, you're right, that I am the same light. I haven't changed at all. And don't worry. You can trust me totally. This was all just a play that I appeared as if I'm not light, see. So it's useless to try and fixate upon anything in this world. Jesus says there's absolutely nothing in this world that reminds you of what you really are. Nothing. And that's right. That's right. For one thing, perception does not enable you to, it inherently distorts. Incredibly distorted. So we have a distortion and then a distortion. The light appearing to be completely distorted into something it's not, and then perception completely even distorting that, and then our thinking even distorting that, and our memory distorting that. So it's just this incredible chain of distortion. So there's nothing that we should be looking for in this world to remind us of what we really are. No experience, nothing. what we can do is shift our attention to the presence of the light that appears as light, which is within us. The Holy Spirit has it within us. It's within our awareness. It's something our attention can be aware of. But it's not, we're not aware of it perceptually with our bodily senses. We're not aware of it that way. So we do have to spend some time giving up this effort to find something in the world that we can attach to and say, okay, this is it. No, there's nothing. Even the great gurus, even their person here, even that is not enough. Even that is not enough, actually. This is something I found out through difficult, terrible experiencing. Even the form of the guru has to be transcended. You have to see the formless light. The formless light. The light that is equally everywhere. And not trying to be anywhere in particular, right? Equally everywhere. This formless, passive, calm, serene, tranquil, still, silent, absolute stillness. This experience enables, that's what enables us to, it reminds us of reality. It helps solve this continuity problem at this level for sure. And so sitting quietly and not paying attention to what's around you and just focusing on your attention towards the formless. And however difficult that may be, it's very difficult. It can be very difficult. You feel very restless. You feel like, wow, you just have to be determined, you know, challenge yourself. Because there's this, the resistance, there's a continuity fear, there's also a wow factor of realizing you can do it, and the freedom is right there for you. It's just like, wow. And you just sit quietly. Ultimately, that's what can help the world, is to encourage people to do this as much as possible. We're not trying to build a better world here. We're not trying to heal the world. We're not trying to make the electromagnetic world a home. You know, it'll never be our home. There's nothing that here that will ever remind us of reality, our true home. Nothing. That's what we asked for. We asked for a realm that didn't remind us of reality in the slightest bit. And that's what we got. That's what we got. But it's still light that's presenting it to us. And this light has not been harmed by this presentation. This is what we need to experience, that the light has not been harmed by appearing to be harmed, or appearing to be different. Or, you know, it's not been compromised. It has not. And this is astonishment to us. It's astonishment. It's the great relief. When we find out that the light has not been harmed or compromised, it's not upset with us, that is the most tremendous relief. You can't even imagine the relief that is to us. It's such good news, you can't even express it. It's not expressible. It's only expressible in terms of just the totality of it. Trying to express it personally, no, it's bigger than that. And so it almost invites just this extreme passivity, sitting where you're not trying to personalize anything. Personalize. This news is absolutely wonderful. And it's so wonderful. All we can do is invite others to experience it. That's it. You can't personalize it, really. No. It's totally impersonal. It's so great that you cannot even fathom how you can personalize it. Because it's total good news. Complete good news. Not a shred of bad news there. Zero. Zero. And how can any person view such a good news? It doesn't fit, does it? from a perspective of a body, a person, a persona, a personality, it doesn't fit. But it does fit the all, doesn't it? It's such great news. So we have to practice letting go of the idea that we're supposed to, what we need to share is just a personal sharing. See, we've been very much caught up in what Jesus refers to as the special relationships. And Jesus is very, very adamant that these are the worst things ever. you got to give him Jesus as due. I'm sure he's right about that. He can be very adamant about stuff, and I'm sure people are like, maybe they kind of cherry pick through that, but you got to say, you know, he's probably very accurate about that. So just give him the benefit of the doubt on this. I certainly do. And I would say, because the good news is complete, it is total, it is universal. Every single aspect, everywhere, is included in this great good news. The light has not been harmed. Hallelujah. The light has not been harmed in any way. That is like the most fantastic news to everywhere, everything, every possible, all of creation shares in this great good news. And so when you are a bearer of this great good news, it is a very impersonal kind of conveyance. Because what you're conveying to everyone is that it is a total universal fact. And therefore you are a universal citizen. You are universal because the light is universally well and has never been harmed in any possible way. It is totally universally functional in all realms, in all possibilities. It is 100% functional. And this means that we are all 100% free. And therefore we are free of the binds of definition that we thought we needed to function as bodies, as personalities, all this. We're free of that. So you can't really direct it at a person, say, hey person, this is for you. It's, hey spirit, which this is for you, and spirit is unbounded. Spirit is unbounded. Oftentimes, this is conveyed in silence. Some of the teachers say the best way to convey is silence. Ramana Maharshi was one of those teachers who said his conveyance is much more powerful in silence than in speech. The trouble is, when you try to personalize this great good news, then that can lead to special relationship just becoming euphoric with one another, so to speak, and an obsession can form, and thinking they need to act out this supreme happiness. And you cannot act this out. This is a universal fact of infinite, endless truth and possibilities, potentialities, all resonating with this truth. You cannot act it out. Trying to act it out through a body is the problem. That's a big problem. And of course you get many people who try to do that. And that's not the way. That is Jesus is. That is big trouble. That is why the past de-emphasized the body, de-emphasized the appearance, the personality, all that stuff, de-emphasize it, because the news we're about to receive is spiritual news that everything's okay with the light. See, we thought the light has been lost unto itself and died. And something different came up of that death of the light. And the light is here to tell us it did not die. It faked its death. Kind of like, what, kind of like Elvis, I guess. Or who faked their death? I don't know. There's a bunch of theories about people faking their deaths. And one of them is Elvis, of course. And they say Elvis is living over in a trailer park in England, actually. Just stay away. I don't want anybody here. So light faked its own death. Light faked its own death. Okay. And so it's literally light. Imagine if we thought life died. Light, which is life, died. And now we're stuck with this death state, you know. And this is, we're functioning with the dead light, the memories. Or really, this whole electromagnetic realm is like a memory of light, as if light died, and we're living on memories of it, really. And we have to include the death of light in those memories, which is why we have all this death and everything here. And then imagine one day, the light comes to you and says, hey, guess what? I'm alive. I never died. I faked my death. Imagine how we would feel as spirit. Imagine how we would feel. Imagine the shock of that. Okay, so the spiritual path is really a way to get ready for the shock of that revelation. Get ready for the shock of light coming to you and saying, hey, I faked my death because you told me to. Remember you told me to? Remember you told me you wanted me to light to die, so I faked my death. So you would think then you could live on memories of it. You're living on the light that isn't light, a memory of light, right? Living on a memory of it. And yet, of course, it's light itself that is the play of memory too. But it doesn't seem so, does it? So, literally, light one day is going to come to you and say, hey, I'm alive. I never died. I faked my death. The cat is quite sick. The cat is here. The cat is very much in his final days. But again, all death is like living on a memory of believing that life, the light, died. So how can we absorb this good, great news that light did not die? God is not dead. God never died. Light never died. When all this time we've been living in this presumption that it did die, this whole electromagnetic realm is the presumption that light died. That's what it is. And we're living on the memories. And the memories include the death of light. And so we have to say, well, how could that have happened? And so this whole electromagnetic spectrum realm is trying to adjust to the belief that light died as if it were a fact. It's not true. It is not true. So all this adjustment we've made is not really necessary at all. This realm is not necessary. This realm is based on the belief that light died, and it's not true. So again, all these adjustments are not necessary. We don't need to live on a memory of light, you see. So everything we're doing in this electromagnetic realm is like, how can we be happy without the light? How can we be happy without the light? And so we get special relationships. We try to get all this, you know, whatever we can do to try and be happy without the light. And of course, it's impossible. Nothing satisfies. We're still bitterly, we feel bitterly unfulfilled no matter what we do. Okay, so again, the news we are preparing for on the spiritual path is the news that the light never died. And this is such great news that how can we even put it into words? You see, how can we even put it into words? Now, there are some who know this for a fact, and they've already gone through this recognition, and they're totally established in this knowing this is a fact, and the continuity fear is gone, etc. You know, those are the great teachers, you know. And some get sent from the clear light here, some are the arhats, some are the, you know, there's some that are the never returners here. They, you know, they've done that. Those are very helpful. Those are very, very helpful. The rest of us are preparing. I'm preparing. The light has come to me on numerous occasions, and I said, what was this? I thought you were dead. And then it disappeared again because I was so shocked. You know, so shocked. And so I have to work out this shock. It can take a lot of time and effort, actually. You take a lifetime of gradually acclimatizing yourself to this news. And I've done a lot of work, so I don't know how it's going to go. I can't really measure, you know, how severe the continuity fear still is. I don't know. It's a tough one to measure, really. It really is. It's less than it used to be, for sure. For sure. I don't know how deep it goes, but I know it's a lot less deep than it used to be. Just the capacity to talk about this mean you know, clearly and self-evidently means its continuity fear has been, you know, way less than it used to be, for sure. Because then you say, oh my gosh, maybe the light will know that I'm not, that I know that it didn't die, so it's going to come to me, you know. And you think you're advertising, like, hey, I'm ready. So, you know, that can be a frightening thing in itself. Absolutely. Very frightening thing. Most people are way too frightened to do that. They say, no, I'm not ready for that news. That's too shocking. Too shocking. It's like someone leaves and you think they're dead, and they come back 30, 40 years later, and you've built a completely new life, right? And you say, oh my gosh, what do I do? I've completely built a new life. We've built this life, this so-called new life, on the memory of the death of light, and we've tried to adjust and accommodate for this to such an extent that when the light comes back to us and tells us, guess what, I didn't die, we say, oh my gosh, what do I do? How do I adjust to this? I have such a massive amount of adjustment, you know, to functioning as if the light did die. And so, you know, you can be freaked out by it. I mean, the light first came to me about, 1978. And I've gone over that story before. I picked up this abandoned infant. And nobody would claim it. I said, I can't let this infant die of exposure, you know, nobody will claim it, so I'm stuck with it. I said, wow, what a terrible fate this is. But I just got a compassion. I said, no, I can't let this infant die. And it turns out the infant was the light, It revealed itself to me as the light, the living light. It showed me it was totally unharmed, totally functional, 100%. And that's when I said, wow. I got a continuity fear here. What do I do? I've been trying to adjust to the memories of the death of light, and now it turns out that light is not dead. And then over the years, it's come to me again and again and again in different ways. And I'm asking for it to show up now on a permanent basis, because that's helpful for the world. It's helpful for the world. It's helpful for everyone. To realize there is this good news that you do need to get ready for. Now, the battle in the world is between those, attention, where your attention goes, but those who believe the light has died and believe therefore your attention needs to be on adjusting to this fact, and those who insist the light did not die, it faked its own death, and therefore you need to get used to accepting this fact and that you don't need all these adjustments anymore. In other words, I don't have any needs. I have no needs. I truly have no needs. Get used to that fact, meaning I don't need to adjust to the death of light. If light didn't die, we don't have any needs. Light will provide whatever we want for, whatever we want. It's impossible to have needs. Only if light died could we have needs, okay? So when you say I have no needs, that means I'm saying light did not die. It faked its own death. And so getting ready for that is a spiritual path. Getting ready for that good news. And I found that sitting quietly, the ability to sit quietly is so important. The ability to be focused on, just imagine there's the best news you could possibly ever hear. And start to feel that good news. And there will be some destabilization. You'll feel like, wow, I don't even know if I can handle this. It's staggering. It's so wonderful. I mean, you mean to tell me I don't need any of these adjustments? I can be free of them? Yes. Yes. It's too good to be true, right? It's almost too good to be true. Because this world is just brutal. Just brutal. That's being very kind to say it's absolutely brutal. Very kind to this world, actually. Besides the point that there's nothing here that reminds us of what we truly are in the slightest bit. How brutal is that? You know, it's just incredibly brutal. We're trying to adjust it to the terrible news, the death of light. We're trying to adjust to that. We've worked so hard adjusting to it. We don't want to give up any of that effort, right? Because then they'll think we're right back with this raw, horrible news. And we said, no, I just can't stand that bad news. We've got to keep moving forward with our progress and putting our attention on physicality here, and try to be happy. You know, try to let that good news, the bad news of the death of light, try to forget it. Try to get happy enough here. Distract yourself. That's what the world is all about. But we know light faked its own death. It didn't die. And it will come to us and say, hey, I didn't die. I'm here right now. Here I am. The light has come. As Jesus says, the light has come. The light has come. Jesus puts a big emphasis on declaring about the light. And now I step into the light. The light has come. It prepares us for this great good news. We're aware of the presence of light, unharmed light, the light that never died and never can die. And you can actually rehearse as if this is happening. Rehearse in imagination. Imagine it's happening. This is the best teaching, to rehearse it, to say, yes, it's going to happen. And it's happening right now. The light is here, you know. And just really get into imagining that this is happening, and then your reactions. And this way, your reactions begin to calm down around this great good news. And then don't worry that you cannot express it personally. Because, of course, the world will demand that you express it personally, because what they're really saying is, well, how does this good news that you got, how does that help me get over the death of light and be happy here? That's what the world's really asking you. Okay, how does this help me forget that awful, terribleness, that the death of light, and how does it help me distract me from that? And it's not distracting you from the death of light. It is the actual news that light never died. So what you can say to others is that, well, simply I found out that light faked its death. And now it came to me and showed me that it never died. And so I'm aware of that, and this news is like a universally applicable news, total universe to everything, always. It's unlimited good news. So the thing to do is to rehearse, begin to rehearse and get ready for this good news. That's what you can convey, tell people. And it may take a while to sink in, for sure. You just have to be very patient and keep repeating it. So, if you're looking for a teaching situation, it is the ones who can, who insist that you do this rehearsal, insist on quiet sitting and rehearsing this, not on a personal level, depersonalize the whole situation, because it's a universal experience. The entire universe experiences it with you. Everything. The entire unmanifest and manifest too. All the unmanifest is unlimited good news. So you begin to drop the chit-chat and focus in on rehearsal for light coming to you. Light will come to you for sure. The light is there. It's come to me many times. And I say, why don't you stay? And it says, well, you're not quite ready for that. I say, oh, okay, how can I get ready for that? One of the things is don't personalize the news, because then that brings troubles, because the person says, how can I be such great news? Especially when he says, how can I possibly be such great news? You know that kind of thing. And it just becomes fanatical situations and stuff. You don't want that. So you be quiet, be still. Prepare for the great good news. Light will come to you and say, I faked my death because you asked me to. Remember? And I didn't. I never died. I never died at all. So you don't need to live on memories of light and the memory of the death of light. You don't need to live on that. You don't have that need at all. You do not have that need of this entire realm. You really do not have the need of this entire realm. You do not have the need of form, actually. You do not have the need of form. There's no need. You can keep form, but you don't need to. You don't have the need to, right? If it's pragmatic, sure. This light is very pragmatic. Holy Spirit is very pragmatic. And realize this is the same good news that is in store for everyone. For everyone, without exception. Everyone is going to get this great good news eventually. And it'll be the same, really. The light faked its death. It did not die. I said, light did not die. It can't die. It cannot. It was just following our orders, our desires. We asked it to die, but all it can do is fake its death. But it did a great job faking it, didn't it? Of course. Of course it did a great job. And we could thank light for that. Say, light, okay, I did a tremendous job. That's wonderful. Wonderful job. Now, those who accept this news and can accept it in full, they're called enlightened. Enlightened. They know and they've accepted, and light faked its death. It cannot die, it never died. And the presence of that light is now with them. They accept the presence of that light with them. They don't have to say, oh, wait a minute, let me go check and back to, put my attention back to the world, and I want to see if this is right or not. Let me see if I can figure out whether you're telling the truth or not. They know the light is telling the truth, so they don't need to keep referencing this silly play here. They don't need to keep referencing it. They know it's true. And so then they're enlightened. That's what enlightenment really is. So we're all going to be enlightened at some point, everyone. So we're all potential enlightenees. We are everyone. So you look at everyone that way, they're going to be enlightened too, because eventually the Holy Spirit will align them so they can, accept this great good news too. And light will come to them too. It's a universal fact. There's nowhere else to go. But truth is the only place there is. Light cannot die. There's nowhere else to go but that truth. So this self-evident type of teaching, we can handle this, but it has to be in this sort of quiet sitting mode, I would say. Otherwise, people will start referencing back to other special relationships, etc. And say, maybe, is this true? And if, how do I act this out here? And maybe we can use this to be happy here, and this information to be happy here. So you have to be committed to not doing anything about this news physically. This news is so absolutely total that it like radiates. It has a presence to it. And it's not a physical radiance or a physical presence. It has its own presence to it. The enlightened ones have this presence of this light. A light that is, that appears as light. Not as dead light, the light that appears as light. So we don't have to do anything except to accept this good news. That's it. That's all we need to do. Accept the light in your own awareness, attention. Accept, okay, light, you never died. I accept this fact. Without needing to reference back to the world and try to double check it by looking at this world, which will certainly confuse you, because this world is totally based on the belief that light did die, so of course it's not going to support what light told you, of course not. So you have to realize that the world is sheer ignorance. I mean, ignorant of the fact that light did not die, total sheer ignorance of this fact. So how can that reinforce truth? It cannot. So somehow the teachers have a way of functioning here, but they do not ask the world for truth, what is true. They directly know from the light what is true about this. So we're pushing ahead as fast as possible here, because the adversary is pushing ahead as fast as possible. The adversary is saying, we know the truth, we know that light died, we know we must forever deal with this, and we want to do everything we can to forget this horrible memory. We want to do everything we can to be happy in this realm. This is our realm now. This is our reality. We have no other place to go. This is it. So let's get our full effort. Let's everybody get on the same page and do everything we can to push forward with happiness in this realm. That is their belief, and they're fanatical about this belief. Don't underestimate the fanaticism of this belief. Zealots, fanatic zealots. They don't even realize it, though. They think it's all righteous. They think they're in a completely righteous cause, and therefore, no, the others are the zealots, but they're not the zealots pushing, you know, this falsity, actually. So they're on the march. They're on a blitzkrieg right now, on a blitzkrieg. So I'm pushing things as fast as possible. The Holy Spirit's given me the opportunity by not giving me any work. Nothing to do. And so I'm just taping, pushing this. And this is really, for me, it's great information, actually. I hope it's great information for you, too. Because it's all becoming self-evident. It's all becoming self-evident now. Wow, this is the path, this is the truth, this is the way. When Jesus said, I am the light of this world, meaning I am the light that comes into this world, that is here for you, the light that will tell you that I never died, the light that will tell you I never died, I faked my own death, as it were. Jesus dying on the cross, it was the death of the body. It wasn't the death of the light. But that was showing us what we have done. We thought we killed the light. And the resurrection is showing us, no, you did not kill the light. You did not kill the light. You did not. And people say, whoa, 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 wow. We've got to readjust this. Wow, it's a heavy thing, right? The light of the world, the light that shows us that it is light, the presence of that. So that light came into the world using a body that people named Jesus, but it really was the light itself. The light is here for everyone. It doesn't really have an actual name at all. It's completely formless, completely nameless. But when that light appears as a body in this world, the world is obsessed with naming bodies and names and stuff. So they say, no, I have to name it this. I got to give it a name to reassure themselves, you know, that, yes, I am form too. You know, light has died, and this person is here to help us overcome our misery over the death of light. It's going to teach us how to be happy here. And Jesus said, no, that's not it. That's not it. I am the light. I am the light, the one light that can never die. And this light has come into the world many times, actually. Many times. And actually, it will come to everyone. It will come to everyone. Whether it actually has a body appearance with it, which has happened various times, or it comes to us within our own spirit, and we become enlightened. See? Absolutely. We absolutely can be enlightened. It's simply accepting this and being able to absorb this great good news. But the real heavyweights is the light. It takes on a body here, has a body moving around, and that really, you know, shocks people. Shocks people. Very powerful kinds of presence there. Very powerful presence of the light. But it's all helpful. It's all helpful. It's all helpful. Any situation of enlightenment is profoundly helpful, actually. Profoundly helpful. And all those who are on the path are also profoundly helpful. Because they're saying, they're accepting their own enlightenment. They're just saying, I just got to get used to this good news. It's taking me a while to get used to this good news. But then, in principle, fundamentally, they've accepted it. Say, okay, I accept this. And that's what I did. I accepted it. I said, okay, yeah. Light faked its own death. I accept it. That is true. And I just have to adjust to this news. That's all. It's taken a long time to adjust to this news. Probably we could do it quicker than I've done it. And maybe there's quite a few in the world who are right there ready to accept this entirely, you know. It's very possible. So we'll just keep on pushing as fast as we can right now. As fast as we can. Like the hounds of hell are after us on our heels, you know. Because really, it is. The false teaching is super aggressive right now. Ultra aggressive. And becoming ultra emboldened. Oh, and the combination is like an avalanche. Avalanche, avalanche, avalanche. So you want to be on the top of the mountain, right? Because there's no avalanche that can reach you on the tippy top of the mountain, can it? No. It's going to be below you, the avalanche. So get up to the top of the mountain where you receive the good news, as Jesus called it, the gospel, means the good news. You receive the gospel, the good news, that light faked its own death, and it never died. Light never died. Okay, and keep pushing on this. Keep absorbing as much as you can. Stay out of the pit of physicality, sensuality, trying to be happy with the bad news, which is what this world is, attempting to be happy on a foundation of the bad news, of the death of light. You can never be truly happy on that foundation, so don't even bother. Don't even try. Don't even try. Give up your efforts. It's ridiculous. Okay, very great. I'll end this video now.